Check this out. This is Big Sur, California. This is Friday, October 2nd, I think. Maybe it's the 3rd. And this place is about as scenic as it gets. It's just awesome. This bridge over here. Beautiful architecture. Awesome. This is looking north right now. This is right along the beach in Big Sur at the Andrew Molera State Park. And I'm gonna go out here and try to catch some waves here pretty soon. Already quite a few guys out. Here comes a wave. Out there. Yeah, I adjusted the camera, so hopefully while I'm talking today you can see a little live surfing action in the background there. You know, basically what I wanted to talk about today is kind of the same theme that I typically get into. And I think I'm going to title this video A System That Is Fraught With Deception, or maybe a smorgasbord of fraud, corruption, and open criminality. Because really, that's the rule of the day. And the rule of the day has been decided by a tiny elite group of miserable, money-loving thugs. And I could come up with a lot of pejorative terms to describe these people, but you know, that's good enough for the most part. And we all really have to just understand how profoundly, how thoroughly we've all been made to believe that this system makes an iota of sense, any sense at all. And it doesn't. And I've examined it up one side, down the other, and around. And it's all conjured up. In fact, these people at the very top are very sorcerer-like in their occult dealings and their nefarious activity. And the evidence for that you could find on the printing of a $1 bill. It's loaded with symbology of the occult. And really, when you examine this thing, you really find out who's at the very top is not necessarily a human being, but it's an entity. It's like a spirit, the spirit of Satanism, of evil. And that's who is running the lives of the people that are running our lives. So it's very important to be able to break away from this conjured up reality that we're all forced to live under. And understand that if we're ever to be free, we've got to be free from some very fundamental realities that we're all immersed in today. And first and foremost is this money-based reality that we're all born into. And we're all told that, hey, you know what? This is just the way it is. And it must make sense because this has been going on for thousands of years. But I'm here to tell you it doesn't. And I'm here to tell you that you shouldn't blame capitalism, because every word has a definition depending on how you're using the word. Of course, some words could have as many as a dozen definitions. But it's important to have a meeting of the minds to understand the particular definition we're talking about. And if we're talking about capitalism, we're talking about principles, laws like supply and demand. We're talking about the fact that that capitalism has inherent qualities. It has inherent components. And a couple of those are, one, it involves risk. That if you are going to take a gamble and you're going to build a particular widget, then you're taking the gamble that everybody else around you is not going to build the same widget. Because if they do, then you know you're not going to be able to get much for your widget, because there'll be this huge oversupply of your particular widget. So that's the risk involved. And another thing it involves is competition. And you can see how these things are all tied together. So supply and demand. Supply and demand is a very simple philosophy. It is a very simple law, rule of thumb to understand. And it's basically this, that if you supply more than you demand, then you realize an oversupply. And so your cost, your burden to purchase those things goes down. This is what is supposed to happen in a free market, supply and demand based capitalist system. So what we've got here is we've got this tiny group of elite manipulating our thoughts, our minds, our belief systems, and telling us that somehow this all makes sense. That, well, you know, that used to be, but now we're progressing, which is really digressing. And now you understand that in order, if we've got a huge oversupply, and we've got to raise the price of those items so that we compensate for the lack of sales. So it's going the opposite direction. You understand that if we just had one thing as simple as sound currency. Okay, sound currency requires accountability. It requires checks and balances. Then every year, two times a year, three times a year, four times a year, it could be adjusted to the cost price index, because this is a calculable figure, what we're talking about. And it could be, and wages can be reset accordingly. So if you've got your cost of living continually going up, there's no reason in the world why wages should not continue going up in order to compensate for the increased cost of living. As long as people aren't lazy, as long as the system keeps working, people are willing to go to work, there's no excuse for it. Sound currency is worth more tomorrow than today. That's called progress. That shows that it's working, and we're supplying more than we need. So you end up with this excess. That is what's supposed to happen. So your burden goes down, your cost of living goes down, your money, your currency is worth more day by day by day. Until what? Until you've got a situation where everybody is secure and prosperous. You've got a situation where your work week is in slow, steady decline because we find easier and easier methods of producing those things we need. It's really a very, very simple understanding, this thing, supply and demand. But when you've got people fixing prices, what it is, it's various special interest groups that collude together to create one horrendous monopoly, okay? And they set the prices where they want, not where the natural market would dictate that the prices ought to be set. They just set them wherever they want because they're controlling the markets. Okay, there is absolutely no accountability. The money printing class are in bed with the political class. That's all that these top politicians that have the power to stop the Federal Reserve from printing money and invalidate the debt that they've imposed on the American people. And they don't lift a finger. They don't do a damn thing. Not Obama and McCain back in 08, when they had an opportunity, when they knew the vast majority of the American people were opposed to the banking bailout. We knew what had happened. We knew what these people had done to us, that they had dumped all this currency on the housing market intentionally to manipulate markets and cause the price of housing to skyrocket very unnaturally. They knew what this would do. They knew full well this would blow out the pipes of our economy. They knew it would create all sorts of misery and suffering. They knew there'd be all sorts of foreclosures as a result. And sure enough, as I've been following this thing for well over a decade, that did happen, okay? And here in California, the majority of residents are renting their homes now. Okay, and this not only caused the cost of housing to go up, it caused the cost of all housing to go up, and that includes rental housing. Not to just go up a little, but to skyrocket, to make it so that you've got a hopeless situation for the majority of California residents. It's just hopeless. Give up your futile pipe dream of ever having a home. Forget it. It ain't gonna happen. Because now these overlords are everywhere. The overlords are your landlords. And as a gardener, I can tell you again, an analogy of a thistle. And if you don't yank that thistle up by the root, and then you gotta cultivate and dig up any seedlings that might get started, make sure you've eradicated them thoroughly. Otherwise, they come up, and that's exactly what's happened here. Your landlord is working for the money printers. That's who typically investors are borrowing money, OPM, other people's money, from the Federal Reserve Bank. They go out and they invest. All these real estate agents are all in on it. They all go along with it. The appraisers out there working for the banks, they've been going right along with it. And they sicken me. I want to vomit. I want nothing to do with this underhanded deal. This is ill-gotten gain. All these people involved, all these lending institutions, all these scammers. They're all colluding. These people are part of this special interest group that's all in on it. These speculators, house flippers, landlords, investors. It's all the same breed. And they don't give a crap what happens to you. They are not living as a family. They are living outside the bounds of common decency, outside the bounds of the common, of the golden rule. Treat others the way you would want to be treated. Is that really the scene we've got here? Do you think the landlords in California are willing to trade places with their tenants? I think not. So anybody out there that thinks somehow we the people, even after 90% of us were against the banking bailout of 08, the takeover really, are gonna somehow turn this thing around politically, well, you know what? I've got a bridge I wanna sell you because it's not gonna happen. As far as I can tell, this is gonna take something as profound as divine intervention. It's going to take direct intervention from a spirit of goodness that's going to have to come in and help decent humanity and overwhelm the evildoers. And that day is coming, because there's one thing these people, these rotten, stinking, filthy, fruited people at the very top, they can't stop knowledge, wisdom, understanding, truth, accurate information and education. They cannot stop these things. These things continue to grow like a snowball rolling down the hill. So as the light of truth continues to descend upon humanity, that day of reckoning is coming, when it's written that God separates the sheep from the goats, the weeds from the cultivars, the wicked from the righteous. So what you want to do is get on the right side of history. I want to be everybody's friend. I want everybody to like me. I want to love my enemies and bless my enemies. And yes, I'm willing to fight to protect innocence and whatever that entails. I'm not a coward, but I do believe in blessing your enemy and wishing the best, because we need to take God's point of view of this thing and understand that human beings are like snowflakes in his eyes. And as what is a snowflake? It's perfect in its design. And he sees that. And he sees the perfect individuality of that snowflake. And as he's a collector of souls, and he sees that perfection and that individuality, and he wants it. He wants to have everybody to be his friend. He wants us to see through his eyes and to help win friends for him. So we've got to reach out to people with an understanding that we're not exalting ourselves as decent humanity, as righteous humanity above them. Because as it is written, the righteousness of men is as filthy rags to the Lord. But when you've got a choice, you've got a path to take, you could take either the path of the righteous or the path of the unrighteous. And I highly recommend taking the path of the righteous and being on the right side of history and welcoming the ushering in of this new age that Jesus talked about. Because it's got to happen, folks. Good must prevail. If you look through history, we can see periods in history like the Dark Ages, where wickedness really flourishes, where the religious authorities were very authoritarian, and mean, and murderous, and scandalous. And even something as seemingly innocent today as the Holy Bible was banned because this was considered powerful information that the commoners weren't to have. So if you look into it, you'll see these things are true. The Inquisitions, the Crusades, where the Catholic Church tried to control all this kind of information because it told you, you could have church anywhere you want, that your relationship with God is wherever you are, you can have it. You could go into your metaphorical closet and pray and have that one-on-one relationship with God Almighty, that he wants us to think of him as our friends. And we can go to him for counsel and comfort, for advice and encouragement. And he'll be there for us. That's the promise. And he can't lie. So the promises that God makes to us can never be questioned. We just have to have the faith of a mustard seed and believe that it's all true, that there really is a good, holy, cosmic, all-powerful, loving God. I like to think of God as our divine parents. And the way where I get that from is the first chapter of the Bible that describes God as male and female. That's the way God wants to be, like the poles on a magnet. Absolutely irresistible, this force and the procreation that God put in us so we could understand how good it felt to procreate and give us just a little insight into why he did it, because he enjoys it. Just like the joy every parent gets from their child, you know, the good and the bad, you know, we have to take it all. We have to accept the fact that we are vulnerable. And there's so many things that we don't like the idea of happening that could befall our children. But there's not a darn thing we can do about it. We all just kind of have to suck it up and say, God, you know what? I'm trusting you. I know you love them more. And if something happens to my kids, I know that they're safe in your arms, your loving arms. And that you love them indescribably more than I could ever love my own children. So God, please take care of them in their new home. You know, whatever the case may be, we all have to kind of turn it over and let go and let God take over. But anyhow, folks, I really would like to be encouraging. And I get tired of thinking that, you know, I come off negative, because I really don't mean to. I mean to come off really positive. Because I know in the long run, the good guy is going to win. And all through history, things turn around. America was established as a Protestant nation primarily. And I know some horrible things happened with the settlers. Not all the settlers. Some of them were mean to the Indians. And, you know, some of the Indians weren't very welcoming to the settlers. And so it was a, you know, it was a give and take.